let's get right to it. So we left off on Tuesday talking about what? Threats. What else are we talking about? So we're talking about threats, how to defend against them. What was that? Somebody over there? What are the components of security? Yes, in the back, give me one.
CIA.
Yes, what's one of them?
Confidentiality.
Confidentiality. What's the other one?
Integrity.
Integrity. What's the third one?
Availability.
Availability. There, look, there you go. You're already security experts. We're well on your way to becoming some. So, where we left off is we wanted to talk about a clicker that doesn't work. The batteries are dead, that's right. Okay, so the system that we want to defend is a house. So, what's important? So, we want to defend a house, right? We're put in charge of defending this house. So, how do we go about thinking about securing this? Yeah.
Sure, there's glass in the windows, so people can't just go through the windows or things in general.
Maybe. Yeah.
Identify the threats.
Identify the threats. How do you go about identifying threats?
Yeah. Identify the entry point.
Identify entry points. That's getting closer. So how do you identify the threats? So you maybe want to identify where people can enter the system or this house. What was that?
Doors and windows.
Doors and windows, you may want to identify those. What else? Is that it?
You might try to think about how somebody could invade the property.
Think about how somebody could invade, but invade what? Yeah.
Define what a house does.
Yes, define what this house does. Right? So that's an important thing that we're missing here, is if I just tell you to defend a house, is it a tree house? Is it a one-bedroom apartment in a condominium complex? Is it a shared townhome? Is it a one-story standalone house? Is it a two-story house? Is it a duplex? Is it the White House? Would you maybe think about threats differently if I asked you to defend your home versus the White House? Right. You might have a different threat model in mind and different adversaries there. So it's important that we kind of define, okay, what type, and do we only care about the house? It's a two-story house with windows and doors.
This depends. Do you have a yard? What is the yard like? Do you have what's surrounding your house?
Yes, we need to know the context of this house, right? We can't just think about the house in isolation and think of a, even though we will do that, but when you need to actually understand the system and the context that the system is being used. So here we need to understand, is this a two-story house that's on a 10-acre property? Or for those that don't know metrics, it's very large. I don't actually know how to translate acres into other units. But it's a fairly large property where there's nobody else around it. Is it in a desert area like Phoenix? Or is it in a wooded area? Is it instead in a subdivision or some kind of suburban housing where there's going to be a very small lot with other houses all around it, right? And why are all of those things important to think about?
You have different ways of providing security for those houses.
Yes, so you may have different security requirements based on the house and where it is. If the house is in Phoenix, you may care about preventing scorpions from getting in.
Good luck.
You may not care about that in other environments. Right? And it also helps you think about the different threats. Right? So different environments could have different threats. So if you know there's no houses around for miles, you may have different threats than you have neighbors that look directly into your apartment or your building. This could give you different types of threats. So what do you want to go with? Does anyone want to describe their house or a house that they know? too much information, they can find that out. So we'll go with like my childhood home. That's what I was thinking of. I should have put a picture up, but. So we'll go with like a two-story house, built-in three-car garage, so two garage door openers, a yard in the back, kind of classic suburban area. So there's other houses around. It's on a, not a cul-de-sac, but on, you know, just like a standard kind of street. So, what else do you want to know about this house so that you can understand it? Yeah. All the entry points. So there's, let's see, so what's an entry point?
Doors, windows.
A place what? Ooh, a place that a living thing can get through. What kind of living things? Animals or people. So is this just doors and windows that we're talking about? What else are we talking about?
Pipes.
What was that?
Pipes.
Pipes. What kind of pipes?
Water.
Yeah, your water, the clean water, the sewage, right? Those are all entry points into your house. What else?
Ventilation.
So your AC unit, right, has to have some way of getting air in and out of your house. And I'm not a construction expert, although it's funny, we're in the construction building, so we could probably go ask some people about all of these things, right? So yeah, so we need to think about all of these types of things. We need to think about where are the doors, where are the windows, but we need to go further, right? We can't just think about those things that we think are standard, right? Doors and windows, that's how normal people get into a house. Because attackers are going to take the path that gets them into the house, right? Attackers are not restricted to use the most common path into the house, right? I mean, if the front door is open, yeah, they'll just walk right in, right? But if the front door is locked and the doors and windows are locked and there's bars in the windows and whatever, we get into different mechanisms, right? Then maybe they'll think about going in through the water system, which would be gross, or the sewer system, which would be even worse. But there's other ways that they could try to get into the house. What do we want to,
I was going to say they could also go to the walls, so the density of the walls as well is another issue.
Yeah, so depending on what type of threats we're facing, right, a wall is not an insurmountable, I mean, we've all watched enough criminal caper movies and bank robbery movies to know that a wall is definitely not a complete barrier, but it's definitely more of a barrier than, let's say, a door or a window. So what type of threats do we want to think about? What types of threats can we think about as a group here for this house? So I guess we should take a step back. What are we trying to defend?
People and possessions in the house.
People and possessions in the house? So how would that be phrased as like a high level kind of, what's our kind of goal?
Data.
Data? Ooh. It's getting a little meta. Yeah.
Assets.
Assets. So we care about the things in the house, so we care about the assets in the house, we care about the people who maybe, but do we care about all people in the house? If you enter the house, are you automatically cared about? And how is that a rude question?
We care about the people who live in the house and anyone they allow in there.
Yes, okay, so we care about the people who live in the house. Why is that a distinction then from who owns the house?
You may rent the house.
Yeah, it could be renters living in there. So then actually, the owner still may need to get into the house at certain points, but there are legal restrictions on when and how they can access the unit, right? And then, so there's the owners, there's the people who live in the house, and then anybody that they say that they want in the house, right? And the important distinction there is we don't really care so much about the people who aren't authorized to be in the house, right? We're not trying to defend them. Okay, is that it? Anything else?
Also protect from heat and cold, insulation.
Yeah, so actually, so I guess you kind of file that under the functionality of a house, right? Why do we have houses? Part of it is to protect us from the elements, right? Which is something that we kind of forget, although maybe we don't forget it so much when we're inside of an air-conditioned room. right? So we wanna, you know, yeah, so we could maybe think of securing the house by making it a giant metal box with no windows and only one entry point, but that would probably not be pleasant to live in. So then what kind of threats are we worried about? Or couldn't we think about? Are you worried about aliens coming and abducting you from your house?
You're super paranoid.
Maybe. Let's go with why not. Why would you not be so concerned about that? It's not a common threat, and it's a highly improbable threat. I'd say we can consider aliens beaming you out of your house to be outside of the scope of our threat model, right? So we want to limit ourselves to things that we believe are physically possible, right? So that eliminates a lot of crazy threats that we can just say, oh yeah, somebody magics you out of your house. Okay, well that's a different type of threat model, and that's a different type of threat. So what types of threats should we consider?
Burglary?
What was that?
Breaking and entering, burglary?
So somebody, who
someone that we don't intend to come in.
Yes, so somebody we'll call it an unauthorized person. So somebody that we do not, or the person living in the house does not intend to be there, shows up, is burglary. But what about things like the fire department?
If we want them there.
Huh?
If we want them there.
If we want them there? What if you didn't, what if your house is burning down and you're away and they can't reach you to authorize them to go inside your house?
But my house burns.
And that house burns. That's just one metaphor. It's a pretty good metaphor, too. Security through burning.
I think they have implied access, though. Once the house is burning.
Yeah, so that's part of it, right? Is we want to think about these scenarios where maybe we don't authorize somebody explicitly to say, yes, you're allowed in my house, but we kind of have a blanket policy. Fire department can enter the house, and they will enter it if they have to. What about police? The tricky question.
That's a little bit different.
That
situation.
Your authorization or a higher authorization that supersedes you, the warrant, et cetera.
Yes, so then that would get into legal aspects, right? Where they would need a warrant, they would have to go get a warrant, and they have certain procedures and policies they follow, but they do have a legal, and I'm not a lawyer, so I probably misuse terms, authority or right to enter your house at that point. What are the threats? So breaking and entering is kind of even that simple one, it's kind of complex. Yes.
Pests?
What was that?
Pests.
Ooh, pests. Like the scorpions? Yeah, I see. No, maybe I should tell the story.
Like environment or weather?
Yeah, so environment or weather. So we want to make, how would we phrase that as a threat then? So we're worried about people, unauthorized people breaking and entering, let's say we're worried about unauthorized people entering into the house. We're also probably worried about them breaking into the house and then leaving, right? How does that differ from something like a prison? Anybody ever watch Prison Break, the first season?
You're only trying to get out, nobody's trying to break in.
Exactly, their only threat model is people leaving, right? They don't actually care about people breaking in. I mean, I'm sure they would care, but not as much as they care about people getting out. Right? Contrast that with a house, you actually care about both, right? You don't want unauthorized people to enter your home, you also don't want unauthorized people to leave your home, right, with the stuff. I don't know how you design it the other way, but you have to be explicit, you want to think through all these threats to make sure you're covering these aspects. What else?
Resources that are used by us within the house, like say energy, we want to make sure that neighbors or someone else wasn't stealing the power that we're paying for.
Ooh, that's a good one. Yeah, I hadn't thought about that. So yeah, so there's certain services, certain kind of inputs to our house, our water, our power, our cable box, satellite, whatever, right? So we kind of want to ensure that we have exclusive access to those resources and somebody isn't trying to siphon off those resources. That's a good one. This is fun. This is a fun Could, yes, that's interesting, so.
Not sure how you protect against that, though.
Yes, but it is a threat, and that goes back to the security component that we talked about of making sure that your house can properly shelter you, right? So this would kind of violate that. We can think about a tree falling. I think that's more in the realistic threat aspect, depending on where you live. A cactus falling. Yeah, so maybe it's important to think about the security not just of the house itself, which we have been focusing on, but also the surrounding property, right? I don't want people to find my buried gold bars in my backyard, so it's on my property, right? So that's actually a really good one. Let's ignore it a little bit for now and just say that we just want to focus on the house because we can go crazy with this. I don't want to go too crazy. Yeah.
What about exceeding authority? So somebody you allow to come in, but then they remove your credit cards when they leave.
Okay, so good point. So is anybody allowed inside your house, allowed everywhere in your house?
No,
they shouldn't. They shouldn't be. Right, so yeah, that's a good point. So there may be other, so there's not only other threats of an authorized party entering your house, but leaving with one of your assets that does not belong to them. But then there's also this component of authorized people entering your house, but entering areas that you don't want them to go into. Right?
Sounds like you need to get better friends.
Sounds like you need to get better friends. Yeah, that's like probably a good, true statement.
Batter service is that which tries to steal your stuff.
What was that?
Batter service is that which tries to steal your stuff.
Get friends that don't steal your stuff.
Or services, like you have someone come into your house to clean up or something.
Oh.
They clean out your.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah. So you hire a cleaning service to come in. They're only authorized essentially to clean your house, and they literally clean you out and steal everything. What else? Yeah?
The control, like your electricity or water, someone can turn it off and turn it on outside of the house.
Yeah, so that's actually, so that affects your environmental comfort in your house, you could say. So somebody could, at a very coarse level, just take an axe to your power cords, right? I don't know if that would kill you right away. I don't know about a computer scientist, not an electrical engineer. They could do that, or they could, let's say, even something crazy like hack into the power grid of the local, SRP, and then disable the power to your specific house. And do that when it's 120 degrees outside, you're gonna have a bad time. What else? Yes?
You might have pets you don't want out of the house.
Ooh, good one. Yeah, so we may have pets, or we may have pets that we want free reign in and out of the house, right? So they have doggy doors that people install, but that has other issues. But yeah, so there may be living things, people, well, I don't think people, maybe kids. I mean, I don't know, you probably don't want a kid to go outside of the house at all times whenever they want. But I don't really know. Yes?
What about people you allow to come in and then they refuse to leave?
That's a good one. Yeah, so people who you are authorized to enter your house and you've authorized them and want them to leave, so now they are not authorized to be there, and they continue to be there. Yeah, so actually, there's this whole problem with squatters and squatters' rights, and there's a whole legal thing behind there. So, yeah, it's interesting that that's actually, that situation comes up and people have to deal with it. Yeah?
So, traffic around your house, like also like major roads or things like that, that may be near you, or maybe people or teenagers decide that they want to drag race past your house.
So maybe that would be, let's say, we didn't really talk about it, but kind of part of the quietness of your house or your being able to, there's a term, quiet enjoyment or something like that. So maybe a part of that environmental thing is you want the house to be livable, right? And so if it's so noisy, yeah, that's tricky. Anything else? people causing any kind of damage. I was thinking about the cars. If somebody drives a car into your, which apparently it looks like only happens in movies, but.
No, it happened to my house.
It happened to your house?
Yeah, we had a wall, fortunately.
Ouch, that's good. Wow. Yeah, so arson, so somebody burning down your property. Your insurance company might be worried about the threat of you yourself burning down your property for the insurance money. Any other threats that we...
Termites or like wear and tear?
Yeah, so pests. So not only, so we kind of talked about, I don't know, scorpions are pests for you, right? For the people living in the house. But you have other pests like termites, which actually cause active damage to the property and can completely destroy your property. What else? Yeah, so I feel like you're kind of getting at like the privacy aspect a little bit, right? Like people seeing into your house. Ooh. I see. Okay, so you could so people coming into your house basically, or you could even think if the plans of your apartment or house are like public knowledge and listed publicly somewhere, then people would know kind of the layout of your house. That's good. There's another hand up. I saw it. Yes?
With like smart homes and stuff, for instance, you probably wouldn't want people taking control of your thermostat or that very stuff, so kind of the network inside your house.
Yeah, so even if we, let's say, if we kind of abstract that a little bit up and say, you know, there's a lot of environmental controls and things that control the heat in your house, the water, these are kind of all kind of related, right? So electricity, so you want to make sure that your authorized parties are in control of that. Yeah.
So air quality, like dust, allergens, chemical attacks.
Yeah, air quality, that's a huge thing here. I was actually shocked when I moved to Arizona and they said you have to replace your air filter every month. I didn't understand what they were talking about until I saw the dust storms. Yeah. Yes, so that's a good one. So we talked about different scenarios with authorized and unauthorized people, but the one we didn't talk about is you invite someone into your home and then they let in somebody else who is not authorized. Yeah, cool. Okay, we do this for a long time. So then what are some policies we should put in place in this home? What could we put into place? And what types of threats would these policies combat? So A and B, do we want to consider all of these threats, or all threats equally valid? Yeah?
Well, in terms of combating threats, you can just put a home security system in that gives you a little more added protection in terms of people breaking in.
So is that a policy or a mechanism?
Mechanism.
Mechanism, yeah. So a home security system would be a mechanism that you could put in place that would enforce what? So what would the policy be?
Entry, kind of like who's supposed to come in, who's not supposed to come in.
So you want to describe the home security system you have in mind so we can...
Just like one that basically you have to enter like a code when you enter the house within 15 seconds of opening the door to verify it's who it is and you know it's allowed in the house or you know that person's allowed in the house.
Cool, okay, so this is a good example. So let's think, so the policy would be essentially something like...
Who has access codes.
Yeah, only people who know the code can enter the house, right?
Yeah.
And the mechanism would be a security system. Does everybody have experience with this system, with these systems? You raise your hand if you have. Okay. So basically the idea is, so what do you have to do, so as a mechanism, what do you have to do every time you leave the house?
So the arm.
You have to arm it, so that has to then be part of your policy, right? So your policy should state only people who know the access code can enter the house, and every time you leave the house, you must arm the security system, because if you don't arm it, then it's basically useless, right? So depending on how you do this, You can, as soon as you open the door, you have this kind of beeping sound, and if you don't put the code into the system in a certain amount of time, they may call the police and the police will come. So, does this mechanism and this policy combat the threat of unauthorized people entering your house?
To a degree.
To what degree?
Well, I remember when I had like an alarm at my house, you had to make sure like all the windows were closed and all the doors were closed before you could arm it.
Why? Yes, so they put sensors on the doors and sensors in all the windows so that you have to start in a closed system state where all the windows are closed and all the doors are closed. And then the sensors should be able to detect when a door is open or a window is open, and then they'll go off. Good. So we need to know more technical details about the exact mechanism we're talking about, right? Because that can influence how we think about how effective this policy and this mechanism, or how effective the mechanism is at implementing this policy. So does it, let's think about the threats. So this is kind of the unauthorized access threats that we talked about. So does this policy and mechanism combat the unauthorized people? So let's say people you don't know entering your house.
As long as the code remains secure, the passcode.
Ooh, as long as it, what does that mean?
That people don't share it or guess it or figure it out, find a way to, if your passcode is all zeros, someone will figure it out pretty easy.
Yeah, so it can, to a degree, for people who don't know the codes, let's say. So the problem is there's not 100% the people who are unauthorized is not the same set as the people who do not know the code. Think of it in terms of sets. What else? Yeah.
Well, it seems to me that the security system doesn't really prevent people from getting in. It just catches them once they're there.
Yeah, so that's a great point, right? So this, what type of mechanism would this be? The prevention or detection?
Unauthorized detection.
Yeah, it's a detection mechanism, right? It's fundamentally not going to stop. So if somebody breaks a window and gets in, right? The alarm will go off, but they're still in your house, so they still have that time delta from whenever the police are called to when somebody comes to actually do whatever they want to do, right? So is this an effective, should we all go out and buy these things? Silly because we always think that doors have locks, right? But that's actually an explicit mechanism that needs to be added to a door, because if you don't have that, then they're just doors that anyone can go and open. And you have their security system, so yeah, somebody can get in. So it seems like that mechanism alone is probably not enough, right? Because it's only going to detect and literally anybody can get in. So what other mechanisms? Yeah?
It also wasn't specified that there was anything to detect if glass was broken.
Exactly. So this is where security gets really interesting, because it depends on the technical details of these systems, right? So the security system, I don't know if they use vibration to detect when windows open, but there's always those, I don't actually know if these tools exist, I have to assume they do, because I've seen it in enough movies, but if anybody looks it up, the things that will go and like cut the circle of glass from the window, right? There, you're not vibrating or moving the glass, I'm pretty sure these sensors would not be able to detect that, but I don't know.
I think they have the heat sensors. So
mm. Cool, yeah, some of them, and I know some of the ones have motion detection cameras inside the house, so they'll fire on any motion, but those are still also not, potentially not foolproof. So what other policies and mechanisms do we want to add to make this system more secure? Yeah?
Maybe like, if you don't feel secure enough for your door, so like, you maybe have a gated front yard or backyard in a way.
Okay, so we could put a gate around the property to kind of maybe prevent people from getting in. Let's ignore the property for a second and just talk about the house. Yeah.
You could add traps to the house.
Traps to the house? How do you ensure that only those traps go off on those who are unauthorized?
Get a way to disarm them from the outside.
How?
I mean, depending on, maybe if you know where it is, you can sort of unhook it or turn it off.
Yeah, so we could go old school. So you could set up crazy booby traps in your house that people would have to disarm and you would have to tell people about. I think you get into weird liability problems here. You would not want to do, so do not do this in your house.
I don't think you can have a moat with alligators around your house.
Yeah, that I don't know. It's interesting. Yeah.
Policy, just a policy issue. If you have children, that, you know, the policy for them is they don't bring anybody in the house that you're, as a parent, you don't know about,
right,
have authorized.
Yeah, so policy, so part of policy, right, there's not always, as we talked about, there's technical mechanisms, so the security system would be a technical mechanism. But this would be more of a human procedural mechanism, where you say, as part of policy, if you're living under my house, my rules, right, would be if you're under a certain age or just tagged the kids, right, you cannot bring, you're not allowed to authorize parties. Right, only the adults could authorize parties. So yeah, that's a good addition to the policy. Yeah.
If you have neighbors, get to know your neighbors and then show them, like, let them know who's supposed to be in the house. Mm-hmm. So that if they see someone that's not, do they know who's supposed to be there? They either call you or call the police. Like, hey, is that the person that's not there?
Interesting. So yeah, that would be let's say a community policy in some sense, or a neighborhood policy where you kind of talk to your neighbors and you kind of say, hey, you know, it would be great if we looked out after each other's places, and if you saw, you know, something happening to mine or somebody that was, you know, you think is unauthorized to call the police, that's an interesting and good idea. It depends a lot on your neighbors, right, if they're better than your friends or not. Yeah.
Implement a curfew for some type of time that say these people can come inside the house or what time they can leave.
Mm. Okay, so implement a curfew as a form of policy?
Yeah.
So you only want certain people in at certain times. Does anyone want to add locks to this house? No, we didn't add locks. All we have is a security system. Huh?
I take four locks.
Four locks?
Yeah.
We want to describe what you mean by four locks.
I don't know. I'll take locks on all the doors.
Locks on all the doors. Okay, so that would be a mechanism. What would be the policy to support that?
So you lock all the doors at night before you go to bed?
Yeah, so at night before you go to bed?
Before you leave.
Before you leave.
Same for the windows.
And then how do you allow unauthorized people then to access your house if you have locks? Or sorry, how do you allow authorized people to access your house?
They get a key.
You have to give them the key or code.
You have to give them the key, and if you have the security system, the code, right? So you have to give them the key and the code in order to enter. Cool. So does the key system alone, does that implement the policy of only unauthorized people can access your house? Authorized people, yes.
There are lock picks.
There are lock picks, yes. People as well as mechanisms that can pick locks. Yeah.
If you lose your keys or somebody else that you give a copy to gives their key to somebody that's unauthorized, then you're
going
to have a problem.
Yeah, exactly. So now, the thing that allows you entry into the house is this key, right? And this key, anyone who has this key, or what? Is it actually that specific key?
No.
Yeah, what is it about the key? The particular grooves and shape on the front of the key. Wait, which one of these is not important? Right? So it's these little grooves on the key that move pins and certain things so that you can unlock the house. So that's an important distinction. Why?
Because.
Yes. Right, so the important thing is it's not this physical key that is important. So anybody who has this physical key, it's anybody who has a key with this specific pattern can get into my office or my apartment, the house. Right, so it's important to think about what threats are we thinking about, what's our threat model, is our policy and mechanisms actually covering this, because, so like everyone said, if you lose your key, right, anybody could get that key and then get into your place. If somebody steals your key and goes to a store to make a copy, a duplicate of the key, and then brings it back to you, right, you'll never actually know you lost the key, but a copy of your key is out there. They've actually even found, oh, I wish I had a picture of this, so you can, I know they used to, you could do it with soap, so you can push the key into some soap.
Clay is good.
Or clay. Yeah, you can get an imprint of the key and then go make it later. You can take a photograph of the key. So this is why I was worried about showing you guys the keys, although not really, but you can take a picture of that and there would actually be enough detail in there to have you reproduce the key. This actually happened in one of the New York newspapers, I can't remember which one, posted, wrote an article about how do, they called it the skeleton key. So this was a key that, I think it was in the subway system or something, would unlock all the doors because the janitors and the maintenance people had to get in and do things. And they posted a picture of the actual key, the actual size. And so it was literally enough for anyone to create a key that did exactly that. And so they had to change the key and change all the locks. Which then brings up a good point. So it's something we didn't, so we talked about unauthorized. So the key is pretty good about, as long as you can control who has access to the key, then only those, if only authorized people have access to the key, then you're actually implementing your policy. But what about unauthorized people? So let's say you give your key to your friend, you find out they ended up stealing money from you, so you want to not allow them in your apartment or house. What do? You have to change the locks and redistribute keys to all authorized users, which is a huge pain. I remember actually when this happened to me is coming home from college, I think my freshman or sophomore year, and I tried my key in the door and it didn't work. It was one of like the worst feelings ever. It's like, oh, they've changed the locks. They changed the lock and didn't even give me the key or tell me they changed it. So that was fine. You don't have to cry for me. It's okay.
There's also should be a policy with keys like that where you place a scare key. So if you do the lock yourself out of your house, then you find the keys.
Right. So there's a couple of the key. Yeah. So if you lose your key, then you lose access to your house, even though you are an authorized user of that house. Right. So some of the policies that people put in place is okay, we should have a spare key hidden somewhere around the house. Some people have fake rocks that you there's fake rocks that you can get to put spare keys in. Some people have key boxes outside their house, which has, so there's a combo there that you have to then remember and fill out, and that opens to give you the key. Right. So, kind of at a high level, do you think, is this key idea a good thing?
It's better than nothing.
It's better than not having? I mean, you can kind of point to empirical evidence that I have like 5 or 6 keys on my key ring, and I'm sure most people have keys on their persons, right? That these actually are in use and used by, I'd probably say billions is not a understatement. But there's all these problems, right? Yeah. Yes, so this is important to think about, right, is the threats. So what are the threats, right? Is your threat a random criminal, or is it like a criminal mastermind who's an expert lock pick who can pick your lock in 5 seconds, right? If you're worried about that level of threat, then just having keys is maybe not enough. And we didn't even talk about different types of locks. Right? We've all seen there's different, there's deadbolts, right? There's normal, really crappy ones that you can just use a credit card to do. There's, you have the chain that you can put on the door, which should prevent people, even if they have a key, from going in. I guess I can tell a little story. So I was stranded in London coming back from Europe. So I missed my flight, and they delayed a bunch of flights, and I was, had to wait in line for like 3 or 4 hours to get rebooked. So they put me in a hotel, go to the hotel, and this was right before school started, so I had to do some work. So I'm at the desk in the hotel room doing some work, and then I hear somebody like jiggling the door handle, and I was like, oh, no thanks, I don't need any like service or anything, thinking it was the maid or the housekeeping. And so then all of a sudden the door swings open, and I'm just like looking at this person, and there's a guy standing there with a suitcase looking at me. I'm like, can I help you? And he's like, yeah, they said this was my room. I'm like, I'm sorry, I'm already in here. This is my room. He's like, okay, I guess I'll go down to the front desk. So he left, and then I locked and did the chain, and then called the front desk and was like, what the heck did you do? And they were like, oh, our computer systems were down, and there's so many people, we didn't know who booked what room. So now I'm always very good about putting those extra boxes in. Those are important. That was weird. Already stuff in your room. Yeah, that'd creep you out. Although at least there wouldn't be people there to annoy. You could at least slowly walk away. Any other policies, mechanisms we want to talk about here? I think this is important to kind of think through different types of scenarios. Think through not only things that we do in our day-to-day things, but how that correlates and how that affects the threats that these policies and mechanisms are supposed to enforce.
A really obnoxious chihuahua.
Is what a threat? Oh, no, a mechanism, okay. I see, so then what would the policy there be?
Just muzzle.
Oh, good, you don't want the muzzle. So let's say, so that was actually an interesting thing, so a pet. So you could maybe think of a mechanism as a pet that you hope would either alert when there's an intruder, so some kind of barking, so if it's an annoying chihuahua, maybe that's a good alert mechanism.
Or not.
It depends on the false positive.
Because they're always barking all the time.
Exactly, yes.
You don't even think about it.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah?
Is insurance a reasonable security mechanism?
Ooh. How does insurance protect you?
Well, it protects against loss. I was just thinking about like the analog with like, you know, digital systems. You know, you have like CRCs and stuff to make sure that you don't lose your data. Or if you do lose your data, there's a way to recover.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in a similar way, if somebody breaks in your house and steals a bunch of stuff, you can replace it. No harm, no foul.
No harm, no foul.
Well, still go to prison, but just not for you.
Slight harm.
Right. Has anybody dealt with an insurance company before in a situation like this?
Yes.
It definitely can be annoying, and it's understandably why. So that's actually an interesting point. So that could be part of your holistic threat. So yeah, so one thing, so we talked about catastrophic damage, buildings landing, trees landing on your house. So your mechanism to try to defend against that, your policy would be, I want to be able to recover the value of my home if it's destroyed in these instances, would probably be to get insurance. So at that point, you're saying, okay, I'm just gonna pay a little bit of money. And in case these things happen, bless you. In case these things happen, then I'll at least be covered in some sense. Insurance is tricky because it's not actually it's protecting you from the monetary loss. And so if that's the only thing you're worried about, then yeah. But at the same time, you also are worried about unauthorized people entering your apartment, right? I don't think you can buy insurance if somebody comes in and
kills you.
Yeah.
Life insurance.
It doesn't help you very much. But yeah, you have some thoughts.
So, what is the level of the threat? I guess so. The determination of the attacker. How determined are they? I mean, a door lock. If I kick hard enough, I might just kick the door open and be able to get in. Same with the sophistication you talked about earlier. If they're a master thief. So, like, what are we trying to protect against would be my question. What level of threat?
Yeah, no, that's my question, not yours.
Well, I think it almost kind of ties into
depending on the level of the threat, like, you know, I'm willing to like throw in defense mechanisms to this point, but after that, like, if they really want that bad, I have a backup, or like,
yep.
your insurance, like, okay, mm-hmm. you want to change my webpage, go ahead, I have a backup, you can just paint it, spray paint it, I'm just going to dump whatever you do and re-upload my backup.
Yeah, so
they might care to only defend to a certain threshold.
Yeah, that's a great point. And that actually then ties in. So there is a complex interplay between insurance and your mechanisms. Because I know definitely on car insurance, if you say I have an alarm system, your insurance premiums go down because they have data that says this mechanism is actually effective at preventing car theft. And so you can end up paying less money from your insurance. Yeah, that's a great point. There's another hand here.
Yeah, we have to have multiple levels of mechanisms mm-hmm. for your security. So you'd have a guard, then you have a door with a lock, then you have a security system, then you have a pit bull.
Yeah, so this layering mechanism, right? So you're trying to...
They get past the guard, they get past the door, get past the security system, then they got to deal with it.
Unless the guard is busy playing with the dog, and then... it's trying to come up with a case. Because when we talk about... In the physical world, it's different, but when we talk about computer systems, you can layer mechanisms in a way that's ineffective and could actually harm your system. So yeah, that's what I was trying to go with there. But yeah, that's a great point. Yeah, layer, so that's what we talked about, right? So just thinking about the security alarm system, right, is not enough. We also want locks, right? So we want locks, we want that. So similar with your home, you may have a threat that you don't want anyone to just break into your house, but you then may also have a safe there that has an additional combination where you can put things like my gold bars or your... What are the things you put in safes? Passports and yeah, any kind of information you want. Or your threat model may be different. So there's different types of safes you can buy. There's some that drill down to the foundation that are really kind of crazy. And there's some that are really small that are just for, like I have one that's just for fire, basically. It's a fire safe. So I know if somebody comes, they can steal it and take it. But that's kind of fine. I don't keep any valuables in there. I keep the documents that I want safe if there was ever a fire. So yeah, you certainly need to think about the different levels of threat.
On that same line, mm-hmm. people should probably think about at what point you call it being overkill.
Yes.
Because if everything is sort of like, I want to take me into breaking crazy, but then you have this like, I don't know, laser protected safe, it's sort of randomly used to protect it.
Yeah, so that's another important thing. So it's actually difficult to just think about these things in a vacuum when these are things that actually cost money, right? So a safe costs money, a laser defense system costs money, a security system costs money, insurance costs money, right? So this is actually gonna be kind of one of the themes is it really does depend on you, your situation, and the context. So in the context of house, it depends on the people who own the house, the people who live in the house, what's their different risk tolerance and what types of threats are they considering and what's their budget, right? And so the same thing applies in computer systems as well, where you need to think about, it's really easy as security people to think, oh, you've got to do A, B, and C and X, Y, Z and go buy the latest laser defense system, it's the best, but you know, you're talking about like a mom and pop shop that maybe probably shouldn't be worried about those things, or maybe should, it depends on the threats, yeah. So like maybe for the safe, a good example would be, it's probably not where I wouldn't want to keep my wallet in the safe, right? The wallet, you know, my wallet, is something I use every day, I take with me, and so going in and out of the safe, so annoying that I've probably put in a bad password of all zeros or something silly that would completely negate the properties there. So yeah, you have to balance, that's a great point, you have to balance the access and availability and usability of the security mechanisms with the properties that you're trying to enforce. Yeah.
So for a physical property, you can also just say, I put deterrence there, like saying, I have this, but in reality, you don't.
Yeah, so that's great. So this is actually a common technique that some people do is they'll put a sign in their window that says secured by whatever home security system, and not actually have that system. So why do they do that? Deterrent? What is a deterrent?
Something that looks threatening, so.
But why would I care about deterrence if I'm somebody's super, you know, bent on breaking in? What is deterrent gonna do?
It keeps the people who are trying to look for easy targets away from you.
Yes, so that's the key, right? And this again depends on the context, because if you're a house in the middle of nowhere, deterrence is probably not gonna stop somebody because it takes them a lot of effort to move on to the next victim. But if you talk about a house in a cul-de-sac in some suburb, right, there's 5, 10 other houses nearby, and so they'll go for the one that looks the easiest from the outside, whether it is or is not. Yeah.
Or if you have like a beware dog sign, mm-hmm. but you have a little chihuahua, but it also bites people. So you're ensuring that the people are aware that the dog is there, but they'll be like, oh, it's gotta be a big dog, and then people get, oh, chihuahua, and then it bites them. The beware of dog sign was there, so you know that you
have. So you're playing multiple levels there. There's multiple games that you're playing there. But you can even put up a beware of dog sign and not actually have a dog. Right? There's nothing that enforces you there. So.
Barking dog doorbells.
that would be funny. Cool. Any other thoughts? This is a good conversation.
Go along with the tournament.
Yes, so you can have other types of mechanisms. My favorite example of this is Home Alone. Has everyone seen Home Alone? Where he pretends he makes cardboard, or has cardboard cutouts of people, and he has a whole intricate system to show them moving, right, with the lights on, and so people come and are going to rob the house, but they think that there's a big party and a lot of people in there, so this deters them from leaving. So yeah, one technique would be having lights maybe go on timers. What's the downside there?
Cost,
exactly, yeah. So it's again a cost reward trade-off situation. Yeah?
I know a big thing is too, depending on the system, I mean, how we're using this analogy, it's touching two examples, but time. I mean, time is a very valuable asset that a lot of us are using. So use the example of wallet, but I know having worked in computers like network security, it's you want data and information super fast, and that's what makes other, you know, what you're trying to protect more valuable than competition is because you can access your stuff securely but also in a more timely manner than the competition. So you're having to weigh that imbalance in your systems and how you're protected.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, so that definitely goes to the access, availability, and functionality aspects, right? So if you put security measures in place that cause me to have to take 30 seconds to do what used to take a second, right, that could have a huge impact on the job. On the alternative side there, right, you could say, well, it's a lot easier to get into your house, and it's a lot faster if you don't have any keys or locks, right? So it's all about trade-offs there, right? Yeah?
We could implement security at certain times. At night, you have all the locks on.
That's an excellent point. So that's actually something that we often forget when thinking about securing systems is we think about we have to secure it at all times, when really time may be a different, you may have different, for the house example, you may have different mechanisms, different policies in place, let's say at night when you're not expecting any visitors, so that's why you may set the alarm of the system when you're going to bed. You may have different threat models and policies and mechanisms if you're going away on vacation for a week. Right? Then it may be worthwhile to set up timers with lights and do kind of other types of things. And even this applies to business as well. So this is something that is actually kind of an active area of research, is not all assets are valuable at all times. So you think about a company who's about to release their quarterly earnings. That document is stored somewhere on one of those systems, and if somebody outside the company knew what those results were, they could buy the stock in relation to how the results corresponded with analyst expectations. So that data is incredibly valuable on the days leading up to it. So you know, if you were in charge of the security of that system, you'd want to make sure that you were focused on the safety of that data. But on the day that those results are released, then you don't care at all. Right? People could break in and get that data because that data is public at that point. Similar things happen with exams and exam answers, right? Before a test, the exam and the exam answers are incredibly important. after you've taken the exam and after everyone's done a makeup, it's less important, right? And actually, sometimes we give you those things, right? So context and time, the situation, all play into this. Cool. That's a good discussion. Okay, cool. So we've touched on this too, and maybe we can bring this back a little bit to what we were talking about in our discussion earlier. So the goals of having a security policy. So what do you want to do with your, what are some things you're trying to address with your security policy? What was the security alarm system doing? Detecting. So it was detecting threats or attacks. What other types of things? So
is it really detect authorized users?
What was that?
Detect authorized users.
Detect authorized users at a higher level, what's that trying to do?
Keep record of traffic flow. Who's coming in and out.
Ooh, that's a good one we didn't talk about. So we may actually want an audit log or some kind of log of what's happening so that we can answer, not even really detect or prevent, but more try to investigate what happened after the fact. So if we detect that an attack occurred, we can say, okay, how did this happen so we can fix the system? Yeah, that was good. So what about, so what if our, let's see. The house is a hard example, because I feel like a lot of the things you can get around, and they're kind of detection. I think the key example is pretty good. So the key example is, if you have locks on your doors and you use keys, is that a detection mechanism?
Prevention.
What was that?
Prevention.
Right, so it's not detecting anything unless you have some crazy sophisticated system that tells you when somebody's breaking into it. But really, it's about trying to prevent people who are unauthorized to access your system. So the idea behind that policy is more one of prevention, detection. What about the insurance? So getting kind of catastrophic insurance. Does that help prevent anything? Please say no, because that's silly. Fundamental misunderstanding of how things work. Does it detect anything? What does it actually do?
Replacement.
Replacement? So it helps you do what from an attack?
Recover.
Yeah, recover from an attack. Awesome. So we can think about kind of security policies as being in these general categories, right? So why is it important to be able to recover from an attack? This side.
You want to be able to rebuild.
Yeah, you need to be able to, so by being able to recover from an attack, right, you're then reducing the damage. So damage could be, so it depends on exactly what the attack is, but the longer that attack takes place, right, the worse things are. I think that's probably a general, good general statement, right? You can think about if your home is burned down, for every day that it's gone, that is a home that you are no longer living in, right? You have no place to live. So if you can recover from that and rebuild the house in a day, that would be pretty cool. And you could get that home back right away. So you actually, and the ability to recover then may help you think differently about your threats. You may not actually be so worried or scared about fire if you can rebuild your home in half a day, but you cannot, so as far as I know, yeah.
Well, just to kind of summarize, so the need for whatever asset is lost is still there, that's why.
Exactly, and this makes sense, and I think it ties into what we were talking about over there, is this a system, you're protecting a system for a reason because it's necessary for you or for the functioning of the organization, right? So you want to be able to recover quickly from an attack. And so as part of that recovery process, you may want to try to add new policies and new mechanisms in order to prevent that attack. So that's where auditing can help and having logs of what things happen on the system. So, how do we define policies? How did we define the policy of our house?
Looking at potential threats.
Yes, so we created the policy by looking through and thinking about potential threats, right? So then how did we define our policy? This isn't a deep question, it's very... Explain to me, somebody can describe the policy of our house.
Don't let authorized users come in. We described actions to take that were acceptable and actions that were unacceptable.
Yeah, so how did you just explain to me the policy?
Verbalized it, and imagine you formalized it by writing it down in
exactly. So we
language.
Language, right? Natural language. So oftentimes our policies are expressed in language, right? I mean, this makes sense. This is how we think about that. So what's the problem with language?
Ambiguity.
What's that?
Ambiguity.
Ambiguity? Yeah.
So open to interpretation?
It could be open to interpretation, so how do we actually... So, and then how does that impact, could that impact the security of our system if our policy is ambiguous? This side.
You don't know what to do if it's ambiguous.
Who doesn't know what to do?
Well, whatever system, whatever you're implementing, whatever mechanism you have to implement your policies doesn't know what to do.
Exactly. Perfect. So yeah, so policy, so if your policy is ambiguous, right, you may come up with some mechanism, deploy some mechanism to try to implement that policy, but how do you know that that mechanism actually enforces your policy? Right? You may think it does, but maybe, and it could be maybe the person implementing the policy and writing the policy is different from the person implementing and deploying the mechanism. Does this happen? Yes, people who've worked in companies, probably, is the majority of people saying yes. Because you have organizations, you have different job functions, it's somebody's job to come up with policies, it's somebody's job, so maybe groups of people too, so even worse, you have groups of people, each with their different thoughts about what the policy is and what they think it means and what the policy actually says and how to interpret that. Yeah.
Well, you always have some guy sitting at a desk somewhere away from the what's actually happening that doesn't quite understand.
Yes, this often happens with policies, right? You have somebody creating a policy, and the people low level down the chain actually are the ones implementing, getting mechanisms, putting mechanisms in place to try to enforce that policy. And so the low level people, the people implementing the mechanism should say, oh yeah, I put this thing in place, and look, that does exactly what the thing says. And I'm like, no, we meant this other thing. It's much more difficult to problem. So what's the other way? How else could we define policies? Is this the only way? Are we stuck with horrible English?
Jargon?
Jargon?
Like, yeah, technical language, right? Doesn't that when we want to define mathematical formulas, there's a language of mathematics that helps to...
Ah, good. So yes, so let's stop there. it's funny, because jargon, so... I was laughing a little bit because technical writing can definitely tries to be more precise than natural language, but if you try reading any kind of academic technical paper, you could probably see that yes, there is a lot of ambiguity there. So even that still exists there. So we can formally define our policy. Ooh, you could go bottom. Yeah, I would worry about that, so.
Well, I mean, just think about that. If you go to a website and they say, oh, you can't actually access our website without using this password with these characters in it, that's a mechanism that's in place. That's also a enforcement policy.
policy there, I would say, would be that users should have difficult-to-guess passwords. And so then, well, I guess the policy would be users should have complex passwords that are hard to guess. The mechanism would be we have a system to try to enforce that they have certain requirements. So yeah, it's a little tricky because there's, they would say that this is their password policy.
That's even before you're even part of whatever organization you're in,
right,
you're trying to get access to, that you're being immediately given a mechanism that stops you.
Yes, but so the key, I think, is there's always, so even if it's not stated, there is a policy that corresponds to the mechanisms, right? So there must be, otherwise, why are you implementing these things, right? You have kind of the policy kind of is gets to the intent, and the mechanism gets to how actually does that happen. Cool. So math, huh? Formal mathematics, yeah.
Well, in this same thing, you could use diagrams and pictures as another way to express policies.
Is there no ambiguities with diagrams and pictures?
Well,
it depends on what your diagram is.
It depends on what you're trying to do, right?
Yeah. I mean, you could create a diagram of a state machine, for instance, which could kind of precisely define, although a state machine would be kind of a representation of formal specifications. So, yeah, you could.
Well, you see, like if you work in a business, a lot of times mm-hmm. you have to have posters with, like, how to do the Heimlich maneuver.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's done with pictures.
Yep. Yeah. No, that's, and yeah, so there's different ways of expressing, I think, that these are, we're kind of talking about very broad categories here. So yeah, natural language definitely has a whole spectrum of very imprecise to much more precise. But I think once you get into incredibly formal definitions, then you've stepped into the mathematics area. Yeah, I like the diagram idea. So what's the benefit of doing things, specifying things in math? With math, with formal languages?
More universally understood.
Universally understood?
Just, well, here on Earth.
That's not what I meant, but that's funny. I like that, yeah.
Computers can understand it.
Yeah, so I think the key here goes back to the ambiguity, right? So the idea with math is it's formally expressed, we can formally define a policy. Right, we may be able to manipulate it. Computers may be able to manipulate it. They have computer theorem provers that can maybe try to prove something about the theorem. The idea would be to completely eliminate the ambiguity. The universal part was kind of is tricky because you know you need to actually be able to speak the formal language to be able to understand it. Right, so that.
In the sense of numbers are kind of common, like 1, 2, 3, kind of common.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. No, it definitely makes sense. It's just universal kind of implies that everyone would be able to understand it, which may not be necessarily the case. The other one that's kind of in between the two would be some kind of policy language. So there's actually languages. The most famous one is XACML, which is XML access control language. And so it's a way to describe using XML what your policy is. So what are some of the benefits there? So actually it goes back to, I think, your comments. What would be some of the benefits of using XML? What's good about XML? Maybe, yeah.
Standardized,
yeah, so there's a standard, there's a schema, there's, so you know exactly what the file should look like. What else is good? Yeah, you could write XML, right? I'm pretty sure everybody in this room could write XML. So yeah, there's definitely, humans can read it. It's human readable and writable-ish, but it's also nice that it's computer readable. So they actually do have access control systems that you can feed an XACML file into, and the mechanism will go and implement that policy and do it. So yeah, they have all kinds of editing tools around them. So this is kind of becoming the standard, but. So let's stop here, and we'll go into correctness. And kind of on Tuesday, I think we'll kind of close out that overview. Thanks.